Okay. So this is my third lecture, and I'm going to switch topics entirely and talk about fermions in holographic superconductors. So let me first try to explain the pictures I drew at the bottom of the first page of my notes, which I will try to reproduce in some approximation here. So first of all, I'm going to talk about systems whose duals are 2 plus 1 dimensional. So when we think about momentum space, this is it, k1, k2, and omega. Omega, conveniently, will be energy of a quasi-particle or some more complicated state minus the Fermi energy. And one of the features that I'm sure that you learned about from Hong Yu's lectures was that in the normal state, in the non-superconducting state, I mean, black holes with finite chemical potentials are dual to theories that have a Fermi surface defined as a place where there is spectral weight in the Green's function, singular spectral weight in the Green's function, indicating a long-lived, low-energy quasi-particle. So although we don't really understand the details of the field theory, we know it's a strongly interacting Chern-Simons theory that most likely, in most cases, has bosons as well as fermions. Nevertheless, the Green's functions for fermionic operators have this feature, which is very suggestive of indeed a Fermi C. Okay, so you know, as you go up into the omega direction, there is some more or less complicated power law behavior that, again, I'm sure Holland will explain, and I've just made a cartoon of with these curvy lines indicating some non-trivial power. Non-trivial power-like growth of the Green's function as you go away from omega equals zero. And then the whole thing is perfectly symmetrical in rotations of the K1, K2 plane. And so that's what I'm trying to depict with these little dashed circles, that the entire Green's function respects that symmetry. But the main feature of interest is this evidence of a Fermi surface at some finite value, Kf, the Fermi momentum, which is on order the chemical potential for fermions. Okay, so this is the normal state, and this is what Hong, as I understand it, told you about. I'm going to talk about a particular superconducting state where this Fermi surface gets eaten up entirely, almost entirely, by the superconducting condensate. And all that remains for very low energy excitations is two nodes. And that makes me happy because nodes are one of the salient features of non-BCS, non-S-wave superconductors. In an S-wave superconductor, the whole Fermi surface gets gapped out, let's say by the BCS mechanism. There's nothing left at sufficiently low energies. But when you have these nodes, a typical behavior is for there to be some Dirac cone where there's essentially a massless fermion with some shifted momentum. So this is, you know, a Dirac cone shifted from the origin to the Fermi surface. And what I will find is that this Dirac cone is filled with a continuum of states. So it's not just like a massless fermion that's on the edge of the Dirac cone. Instead, it's just something which is a continuum of states. We're not really talking about quasiparticles just yet. But there are quasiparticles going down to this node. They're just slightly outside the Dirac cone. And they encircle it like this. So there's another deformed cone outside this one that I first drew. So it's hard to draw two cones on the same diagram, so I'm just like drawing the contours of this one. And it's not a perfect cone. The fermion normal modes in the bulk correspond to these dispersionless excitations, or nearly dispersionless excitations, that are slightly outside of the continuum Dirac cone. And this is a omega to minus omega symmetric picture. It just gets a little burdensome to draw. Okay, so that's more or less what things look like. And there is similarly another Dirac cone over here with all the same features. It's filled with some normal modes outside it. And this is indeed in the superconducting phase. So my purpose in these final two lectures is to present you with the calculations that lead to this picture, which is a somewhat attractive picture when comparing with real materials, because there's something like this in real materials above a node. There are nearly dispersionless excitations, and then if you get to an energy, let's say a fixed K, that is sufficiently above those nearly dispersionless excitations, then there are multiparticle states which are a continuum. And this, this set of features in the fermion two-point function sometimes goes by the name of peak dip hump, and it's revealed in experiments on angle-resolved photoemission tomography. Pardon me, angle-resolved photoemission spectra.
Question?
Yes. Different regimes, yeah. So there's some adjustability depending on what's going on in the ADS2 region. We could pause to sort of have my take on these extremely Reichert Nordstrom solutions. The great thing here is that we get this Fermi surface, and depending on, like you say, depending on parameters, things can be more or less long lived. What's kind of awful about these constructions is that the ADS2 cross R2 region immediately implies some macroscopic entropy, a ground state entropy, which is very unlike the systems that one is comparing to. So that makes me, I admit, somewhat skeptical. However, it is a feature which can be eradicated by introducing an uncharged scalar into the bulk theory. Then you can arrive at no violations of Nernst's law, and even some nice scaling of the specific heat at low temperatures. And you still have the good feature of a Fermi surface. So I'm not going to go so far as to introduce that extra normal scalar. I'm going to write down a model in a moment where its normal state does have that funny ADS2 cross R2 feature, which, okay, I dislike. But I think it's fairly clear that everything I do would carry over to the case where you have that extra scalar and have some nicer scaling of thermodynamic quantities in the low temperature limit. The question is, does a superconductor have well-defined quasi-particles at its nodes? The answer is, to my understanding, yes, they are at least fairly long-lived. We're not talking about really crisp. If you look at peak-dip pump structures, they do have some width. Exactly why that is complicated. There's supposed to be surface effects that could blur out the feature. So it's not clear to me exactly how you measure the width of a quasi-particle in, for instance, in RPES experiments. Yes, thank
you. Yeah, I'm just a little confused. So the charge carriers in the superconducting state are fermionic. Is that true?
Deep question. The dual field theories, as I remarked, are usually thought of as like M2 brain theories, so strongly interacting supersymmetric Chern-Simons theories. Those are the ones we best understand, ABDM theories more or less.
Yeah.
And they would have charged fermions as well as charged bosons. And so there, from there, you can kind of get yourself fairly turned around. If you have charged bosons and a chemical potential, you might just say, well, fine, they'll both condense. And there's no need for the fermionic carriers to do anything. Mm-hmm. The bosons seem to be the path of least resistance to carry the charge. But then why do you have a Fermi surface?
Yeah, I'm trying to understand this picture you drew here with the cones.
This?
Yeah.
OK. I was talking about this one. You asked about
charge carriers
here.
Yeah.
So, okay, my take on it would be, look, I don't know how to get totally unconfused on the field theory side. However, the ADS calculations are very simple, involving only a few fields. And so they might be expected to carry over to a multitude of possible dual theories, including, maybe, some which have no charged bosons. Then the story really would be what everybody hopes it is, that you have the Fermi C, and here's where it ends,
yeah.
And then you have some kind of condensate, which has to come from some kind of Fermi bilinears or even Fermi multilinears,
yeah.
And that condensate spontaneously breaks the E1 symmetry,
yeah.
And then you get this kind of nodal behavior, since the condensate has some rotational angular momentum.
Is there experimental evidence for that?
Is there experimental evidence for nodes in
yeah.
gaps?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
With fermionic cones, with direct cones?
Absolutely. That's what RPES is sort of best for.
Mm-hmm.
What you're doing with RPES, it's a monster elaboration of the photoelectric effect.
Yeah.
You shine photons on a metal, an electron comes out, you know the incident momentum and energy, and you measure the final momentum and energy.
Yeah.
And from that measurement and good understanding of the surface physics and so forth, you can approximately determine the spectral weight of the two-point function of the fermions in the metal.
Yeah. So this is for high TC superconductors?
Oh, RPES is done on many, many materials. But this kind of behavior where you get the direct cones above the node, yes, that happens for D-wave superconductors, except there you have four nodes, here I have two. This is a P-wave case. Those are not so easily realized in nature, and I don't actually know of any experiment where there's a clean P-wave determination. But the point is, we have nodes in a gap, direct cones above the nodes. Another point where the comparison is not so great is that these are isotropic Dirac cones, well, almost. They're almost perfectly round. And that's rather unlike real materials where the Dirac cone gets kind of mushed out and has a large aspect ratio. So basically, next step is to write down the Lagrangian from which all these nice features come. And it's practically the first Lagrangian that somebody interested in QCD should write down, because it is QCD. Sorry, there's not a bar over my psi, my first psi in the lecture notes on page 2. Okay, so this is, let's call it ADS4 gravity. And this is the Lagrangian of QCD with no quark masses. And writing down QCD here might seem like something a little bit out of left field, but as we go along, I'll explain why this was a good idea. The fermions are going to be dual to the fermionic operator whose Green's functions I am depicting here. And this gauge field is going to be the order parameter that determines that we have a superconducting state. So it's QCD almost, except that the gauge group I will choose to be SU2, not SU3, and psi is in the 2. And there's only one player. That doesn't matter, actually. For the calculations I'm going to do, you could have any number of flavors, and each one would give you a copy of the same Green's function.
How do you know that this Lagrangian is a consistent truncation?
Great question. Answer is, I don't. And that leads me to point out a major gap in the whole literature on fermions in holographic superconductors, which is that, as far as I know, nobody ever has started with a consistent truncation and gotten to the fermion action and then taken the fermion action from the consistent truncation and calculated a two-point function. That's a little horrifying. Many, many papers have been written, not just by me, but by others, on fermion response to holographic superconductors without ever looking at the supergravity Lagrangians. And well, the reason for that is that the fermion terms in supergravity Lagrangians are pretty complicated. They definitely include spin 1/2 Dirac particles. They definitely have covariant derivatives, gauge covariant derivatives in them. The trouble is that there are other types of couplings that you find. For instance, one that springs to mind is you get couplings sort of like that. Now, that's not a gauge singlet the way I wrote it, maybe, but these sort of Pauli-like couplings, you definitely get. These are things you have to account for really in these calculations, because they're still coming up at the, let's call it the two derivative level, where you get each fermion as half a derivative and then there's one derivative here. So including the Pauli couplings in principle should be done, but it gets hard. Another thing that's unpleasant about going through the supergravity Lagrangian is that you have some broken supersymmetry in the bosonic backgrounds. And so that means that the spin 3/2 particles are going to mix with the spin 1/2 particles via the super Higgs mechanism, which is the breaking of supersymmetry. So you've got, you know, in something like n equals 8 supergravity, where the Lagrangian is particularly well known, you've got, what, something like 8 but you have eight gravitinos and then 50-some spin one-half particles, and there's a mixing matrix, and then you have to look at the spin one-half particles that didn't mix, and they've got some mass matrix that's probably big and non-diagonal. So there is a real chore here. There's a reason why people haven't done it.
Is there any reason to choose SU2 instead of other gauge groups?
Actually, I'm going to do calculations which could be generalized almost instantaneously to arbitrary gauge groups and arbitrary representations of fermions. We can talk about it a little later maybe, but you're going to get more Dirac cones. Maybe we can just spell out the consequence briefly. That here you see just two Dirac cones evenly spaced around the origin. And if you remember the weight diagram of the doublet of SU2, it looks kind of like this. There's two weights. This is like spin 1/2, spin minus 1/2. And if you went to a higher representation of SU2, you'd have, let's say, spin 3/2, then you'd have four weights. It'd be 1, 2, 3, 4. And in fact, if you did that with gauge group SU2, you would get four Dirac cones in a row. If you did some funny group like G2 and made the fermions in the 7, then the Dirac cones would be spread out over the K1, K2 plane in a way dictated by the weight diagram of the 7 and G2. All these are very generalizable calculations.
Could you make the GA easily in that way?
The closest you can come, at least in any obvious way, is to pick SO4 as a symmetry group and then put the fermions in the 4. And that even sounds good because the Hubbard model has symmetry group SO4 and the fermions are in the 4. So that actually starts to sound like it should be worth something. I'm not so sure that counts as D-wave, though. We can talk about it later. There is, however, a nice paper that came out recently by Chris Herzog, Francesco Benigni, and Amos Yerom, where they substituted, instead of F mu nu, they substituted the derivatives of a explicit fundamental spin 2 field. So there was, how did it really go? They had an abelian gauge field, which was going to carry the charge. But then, instead of like the off-diagonal parts of the SV2, they had this charged spin 2 fundamental field. It's a very troublesome object because it has all sorts of problems with the unitarity. However, phenomenologically, it looked great. They got deformed Dirac cones in a D-wave configuration, as you might expect from a spin 2 condensate. Anyway, let's move on. The simplest solution of the equations of motion is, of course, ADS4. So I just remind you that my preferred way of writing ADS4 is to make it explicitly conformal to Minkowski space. And as we'll see, that's a particularly useful feature for the calculations I'm going to do. Let me just write out one other little point, that this is a solution, obviously, with A mu equals 0 and also psi equals 0. It remains a perfectly good solution for any A mu which is pure gauge. Any A mu, in short, with no field strength. That seems like a throwaway remark, but actually it's not. You can see that those solutions with non-zero A mu are actually quite interesting. Okay, so Now let me tell you about the zero temperature limit of the superconducting geometries. And we could certainly discuss the non-zero temperature case. And the main feature there is that there is a critical temperature TC proportional to the chemical potential, below which the off-diagonal elements of F mu nu like to be non-zero. But as I say, it's easy enough to discuss simply the T equals zero limit. Okay, and let me just draw it. My limited artistic ability. What I'm trying to draw is a domain wall where here everything's complicated. So for instance, F mu nu is not zero and the geometry is not ADS4. But far from this region, either in the direction of the boundary, which is R2 comma 1, or in the direction of the deep depths of the bulk, the geometry becomes ADS4. It's one of these solutions with this metric, exactly this metric, and no gauge field. And these two regions differ only in that if one of them is chosen to have mu equals zero, let's say this one, at least mu goes to zero as you go to the boundary, then this one has mu going to some finite. I said this slightly wrong. It's the spatial components of AI which I want to have going to zero in the ultraviolet. And then those same spatial components go to some finite value in the infrared. That's really a choice. It's a convenient one, but in fact, the time-lock component of A mu is going to go to some finite value here and some zero value here. But the point is, you can have pure gauge with A mu equals zero here, but then A mu is going to be finite here, or vice versa. That's why I care about these funny solutions where it looks like pure gauge is trivial, but it's really not, because when you have them in the same geometry, there's no gauge choice that makes A mu zero everywhere. Okay, so let me introduce a little bit more notation, a slightly more general idea that we could just have this A mu go to any flat connection A mu ultraviolet in the ultraviolet region, and likewise we approach some other flat connection in the infrared, and then we can conveniently define some shifted momentum vectors . These are functions of z. And I'm also going to insist, as a gauge choice everywhere, that AZ is identically zero. And you'll see these things are very useful objects. And while the reason is transparent, the reason is that the covariant derivative of the fermion is, by definition, the Christoffel connection covariant derivative minus I G A mils A mu A tau A psi. And so when you consider psi equals, some psi hat of z times e to the minus I k lower m x upper m, that would be a nice ansatz to try to find a solution to the wave equation for psi. Well, then you get dm psi equals plus or minus I km psi. Let me see if I can straighten out in my own head the way the dimensions go. I use mostly plus conventions, so I really should make that a plus, and then we differentiate and bring the I downstairs. So yeah, this equation here is the raison d'etre of those capital KMs that they enter into the Dirac equation in natural ways. Okay, so another thing I'm going to care about is the infrared limits of these KMs. They're lovely quantities because they commute with one another. Generally speaking, these KMs are rather complicated objects because they have some SU2 matrix structure. It's one, that's right. So this would be the 2x2 identity matrix. And then this, of course, is also a 2x2 matrix involving the generators of SU2. So at some general value of z, they're not going to commute because the AMs don't commute. But the statement that the gauge field approaches a flat connection in the infrared implies that the AMs commute with one another, otherwise that would be some field strength, and therefore the KMs commute with one another. So I will use that heavily. Although these are matrices, I can manipulate them as if they were numbers because they commute with one another. And same thing with the ultraviolet KMs. However, the KM ultraviolets don't commute with the KM infrareds because it's just different gauge connections. They have nothing to do with one another in principle. Okay, so with these things introduced, let me spring upon you the answer, at least in some approximation, the answer that gives rise to those pictures. Those pictures represent the spectral measure of a two-point function of some fermionic operator, which is dual to psi. So this is the thing which is supposed to have some overlap with the operator which creates one fermion in the boundary theory. It also undoubtedly overlaps with operators that can create a continuum of multi-particle states. So this is a complicated and difficult object. Even in ADS-CFT, you can only really evaluate it using numerics. However, for the purposes of understanding the main features, You can calculate it in what I call the sudden approximation. And there you can get explicit formulas. So I'm not going to show you today results of numerics, except to say that they look like that. Instead, I'm going to basically develop a derivation of this simple formula for the Green's function. And of course, I have to tell you what the Q's are. In terms of the structure of this lecture, I should say that I'm still now in summary mode. I'm trying to give you an overall idea of what the answers are. And then as I go on, I'm going to try to go back over it and fill in all the details. Well, not all, but enough of the details to get the idea of how these calculations are done. One thing I should add is that even for the simplest background of extremal Reister Nordstrom, this KF is determined numerically. So a charming feature of the calculation I'm going to tell you is that I'll wind up computing to the position of this Dirac cone analytically. There is one version of the normal state that I know, where you can handle the calculation of the Fermi momentum analytically. And that was another thing I thought I might talk about. But I believe this calculation overall is more interesting. OK, so remaining in summary mode, let me just define what this scalar quantity Q is. This simple combination where K infrared is a 2-by-2 matrix formed as follows. And of course, A to MN is the metric of my boundary theory, the flat metric there, and likewise, KUV is the square root of eta KUV KUV. Now you might say, aren't you worried about taking the square root of a matrix? That's in principle a tricky thing to do. And the quick answer is that when these k's are space-like, there is no problem because all the eigenvalues of what's inside the square root are positive. And when k is time-like, you have to introduce some appropriate I epsilon prescription to decide which side of a branch type you sit on. But in any case, the simple way to think of taking the square root is you pass to a basis for these matrices where they are all diagonal. And you can do that because the KMs commute. So once again, I'm making very strong use of the commuting properties of the KMs. I can, again, pass to a basis where they're all diagonal. Z star is the approximate position of the domain wall. So again, you remember their story was you had ADS and then something kind of kinky, and then ADS again. And so Z star is this distance, I mean, how far down in ADS you are before you get to the domain wall. Okay, and as we'll see near the end, the QMs and QNs have similar definitions just in terms of the infrared and ultraviolet case. Fair enough. So that is pretty much the end of my summary. Let me also remark that these two lectures, this one and the next one, are based on a paper from earlier this year. So before I move on to the kind of more detailed approach to it all, are there any further questions about what it all means or what my definitions are? Yes.
So on the boundary, whether the robots introduce any
robots? Absolutely. Great question. So I set up my the question was, what are the global symmetries of the boundary theory? I set up my bulk theory so that it had diffeomorphisms, of course, and also an SU2 gauge symmetry. So part of the ADS-CFT dictionary is that gauge symmetries in the bulk correspond to global symmetries in the boundary. So our boundary theory indeed has an SU2 global symmetry, of which a particular U1 is the U1 which I will spontaneously break with a condensate of the off-diagonal gauge fields. So that's going to come as part of the more detailed look at what exactly holographic superconductors mean.
So you would explain which U1 you would
pick? Absolutely. The question was, I will explain which U1 I'll pick. And yes, I will. Of course, it's only a sort of choice of conventions. Let me answer you more substantively. But if you have a charged black hole in the bulk, it must carry some voltage, shall we say, under a particular component of the gauge field, a particular U1 component. And that same U1 is the one that I will spontaneously break. That's the only gauge invariant statement you can make. And by the way, I just note in passing that I know very little, at least, about generalizations, if there are any, of charged black holes that have interesting non-abelian structure. I mean, I'm going to tell you one today, but what if you try to introduce chemical potentials for non-commuting parts of SU2? Has anybody even done that? I don't know. Other questions?
So it's the forming momentum dependent on
The question was, is the Fermi momentum dependent on the gauge choice? No. First of all, I'd tell you that the gauge choice that I've kind of indicated, I haven't made it quite precise, is one that's pretty much forced upon you by saying that you're going to get it as a smooth limit from the non-zero temperature case. When you're at non-zero temperature, then there is this horizon, the black hole horizon, where the gauge field, the non-abelian gauge field, must be well-defined. And if you look at what that means, it implies that the time-like component, A sub t, must go to zero at the horizon. So that already fixes some of the gauge choice, some of the gauge freedom. More is fixed by the statement that by just spelling out a dictionary and choosing the convention that the value of A sub I at the boundary equals the deformation parameter that you would add to the Lagrangian if you were adding a current explicitly to the Lagrangian. So maybe I should develop this just a little further. Because the two questions are starting to seem related to me. So I've told you all about the bulk Lagrangian. What about the CFT Lagrangian? In principle, with a gauge field in the story, you could take its boundary limit I'd rather have lower indices. That makes more sense. Gauge fields are naturally come with lower indices. So little a sub m is just the limit that v goes to zero of this. And you could deform the Lagrangian by a sub m, j sub m, or if we're talking about an SU2 theory, maybe we take a trace or something like that. So let me focus on a particular U1 out of the SU2, and these J's are the conserved currents of the global U1 symmetry in the boundary theory. So this is the kind of deformation that you could easily imagine constructing with these bosonic backgrounds. And the deformations that I want to consider are AM equals mu, comma, 0, comma, 0. So this is chemical potential because it multiplies the charge density, J0, of the boundary theory. That's what you mean by chemical potential. I choose these to be 0 because if I didn't, I would be explicitly breaking in the Lagrangian. I would be explicitly breaking translation and or rotation invariance. I don't want to do that. I want all my symmetries to break spontaneously in order to describe a superconductor which let's say, spontaneously breaks simultaneously rotation invariance and part of gauge invariance. Okay. But I believe the reason I got here was the question about gauge freedom. Once you prescribe that this is what the limit of a sub m means on the boundary theory, then indeed you have to choose the spatial components to go to zero at the boundary. So there's really very little gauge freedom left, and the choices that I made are the right ones. So when you come to the fermions, you know what to do. There's no ambiguity in the value of the Fermi momentum. If you change your mind on the conventions on the gauge field that I specified, probably you could do that, but then you'd have to sort of figure out again what the Fermi momentum means, how to calculate the two-point functions and the new conventions. All right, so let me pause to ask, why did we do this calculation? Well, we had seen the work starting with Sun-Sik Lee's work on fermion correlators in the normal state, and those were explained, I think, at least in an introductory fashion in Hong Liu's lectures. We were also aware of a nice paper by Basu and collaborators. That's definitely worth writing up on the board. Basu's paper explained this picture that I drew of an ADS4 to ADS4 domain wall. We saw that, you know, that seems so simple, this picture, that it was obviously worth looking into some fermion correlators. And another motivation is that while we knew that it was unlikely that exactly the Lagrangian we were writing down would come out of a Lagrangian that you can get from low energy limited string theory or M theory, it certainly has all the ingredients that you see in gauge supergravity Lagrangians. So we felt that calculations done with the simplest of Lagrangians would probably carry over at least qualitatively for the ones that you really get out of string theory. Right, so when am I supposed to end? At 10:15?
Yeah.
All right. So let me get started then on a more in-depth look, hardly exhaustive, as holographic superconductors. So the point of departure is that the main macroscopic features of superconductors have to do with spontaneous breaking of U1 electromagnetism in the material. So for instance, the infinite DC conductivity, the Meissner effect, Josephson effect, and so forth, can all be explained in effective field theory terms starting from that spontaneous breaking. And there's a nice sort of review paper, almost a review paper, by Weinberg. I think it's called Superconductors for Particular Theorists or something like this, which lays out this viewpoint on superconductors rather clearly. So that's point one. And then point two is that much of the theory of superconductors, BCS theory, for example, leaves U1 electromagnetism as a global symmetry until the end. So you don't really need like virtual photon propagators in BCS theory. You know, in BCS, it's the phonons that do the heavy lifting. I'll just say, U1 electromagnetism can often be treated as a global symmetry. So that we could treat it as something that gets gauged only in the bulk. And this spontaneous breaking of the U1 electromagnetic symmetry, whether treated as global or gauged, happens at both finite T and finite mu. So let me draw for you the canonical phase diagram that everybody draws to illustrate that last point. Chemical potential mu is doping, well, it's dual to doping. The point is that you start with something which has one electron per lattice site, and then you introduce doping or impurities that give you extra electrons or maybe extra holes. And if you don't do that, you have a Mott insulator, which is an antiferromagnet. If you do, and the temperature's low enough, and fate smiles upon you, then you get a superconductor. So these are the main clear phases of the diagram, and this is the normal non-antiferromagnetic state, But there's a little bit more to the story, well, much more to the story. There's some so-called pseudo-gap phenomenon, which is stronger at low doping. Not too far from optimal doping, there's some fan-like region, which is a strange metal that I think Fung must have talked about. And then for sufficiently large mu, it's believed and understood that you get approximately Fermi-Lipschitz theory. But okay, for my purposes, what I'm really talking about is that yes, you're after a phenomenon of U1, spontaneous U1 symmetry breaking at finite T and finite mu. Okay, so if that's all you're interested in, spontaneous breaking of E1, then you should naturally start as an ABS CFTologist with ABS for gravity and an abelian gauge field, and then something which will happily break that field. Something that will happily break that gauge symmetry. So you need basically matter fields perhaps both charged so that they can condense and break the U1 and optionally uncharged. As I remarked early on, an uncharged scalar can cure some of the apparent pathologies of the AES Rice-Nordstrom solution. Okay, so let's move right on. The simplest case to consider is an S-wave holographic superconductor. Then the idea is that the matter fields include the Lagrangian of a charged scalar, which we might write as gauge covariant derivative, where now I've only got a U1 gauge field, so the coupling now is some charge Q, and then this scalar field can have a mass, it can also have self-interactions. And so if you look at this, of course what I've done is I've just coupled ABS for gravity to good old Landau-Ginzburg effective field theory. So you might say, yawn, of course I know I'll get some superconductivity out of this, because that's how Landau did it in the 1950s. But there is something novel about this. There's a new sort of mechanism through which things can superconduct, which owes to the existence of a fourth dimension in the story. And speaking of dimensionality, I should add that there's a good reason why I and earlier authors focus on the ADS4 case. It is that real materials, let's say notably cuprates, are layered compounds. The copper oxide planes are planes. And the coupling between planes is relatively weak compared to the coupling among atoms in a plane. So it's at least believed that a lot of the phenomenology can be understood by considering one plane at a time. Perhaps module issues of the Kalman-Merman-Wagner theorem. Okay, so what are the obvious solutions of this theory? Well, in addition to good old ABS4, there's the one I'm ambivalent about, Rice-Nordstrom ADS, where there's some horizon at a finite depth, some finite z, and out of this horizon there comes some strong electric fields, which are straight up in the z direction, so they're only curved to sort of follow the curvature of the geometry. This is the electric field under F mu nu. More precisely, E sub z, let's say, is F zero z, which is minus dz of the scalar potential phi. So I'll try to remember to put these little serifs on phi to distinguish between it and the charge scalar. Okay, so I assume I am now just reviewing things that you know well. The chemical potential is given by the difference of the gauge field at the horizon boundary. And if I went straight for fermion correlator calculations, I would find those Fermi surface features that Hong described. Scalars, and you might ask, will the charge scalars jump out of the horizon by some quantum or super gradient process? And so the heuristic way of understanding how that might work is that, okay, you've got behind the black hole horizon a whole bunch of positive charge, whether it be fermions or scalars, you don't really care if you're talking about a black hole. And then you imagine a single quantum of the scalar field phi, and let's just say that it was a positively charged quantum. If it was negatively charged, things would be boring, it would just fall right in. But when it's positively charged, there would be some upward force on it, which heuristically would be its charge times the upward electric field. Now, of course, I say heuristic because I'm going to give you a sort of Newtonian argument, which doesn't really apply in a curved geometry. It just gives you the right idea. So there is, of course, also some downward force, force of gravity, pulling it into the black hole. And this downward force, again in my heuristic language, would be mg, where g is the gravitational acceleration, just like 9.8 meters per second squared in this room. Now, Hawking's great insight is that that gravitational acceleration close to the horizon is the Hawking temperature. Up to a factor of 2 pi. So this immediately brings to mind the thought that if T Hawking gets small enough, then this downward force will pretty much disappear, and all that's left is the upward force. So that seems to mean that below some certain critical temperature, yes, it's favorable for quanta that manage to be outside for an instant to keep being outside. If this were in flat space, the phenomena that I'm describing would lead to super radiance. You would have some highly charged black hole, and you'd have some scalar fields that would kind of pericreate outside the horizon, say plus and minus. The minus would just fall in. The plus guy would run away forever. And this quantum fluctuation followed by a runaway would be a mode by which the black hole could discharge. That would really happen if you had a highly charged black hole in flat space. But ADS is different because ADS is a box. Nothing gets out of ADS. If the scalar tries to do its super radiating thing, it gets up close to the boundary, but then because of the infinite blue shift of the boundary, falls back down. And the end result can only be that the scalar will condense in some sort of atmosphere near the black hole horizon. So this is, like I say, a heuristic picture based on arguments like Newtonian force balance that obviously don't really apply, but there are better calculations, still rather simple, that verify the existence of such a condensate below some TC. And that's what's new in this story as compared to Landau-Ginzburg theory. What I remind you is that in Landau-Ginzburg theory, it all hinges on the variability of the scalar potential as a function of temperature. It looks like this above TC, and then the mass term at least turns over at TC, and you get this W-shaped potential. It's all, of course, rotationally symmetric, and the scalar slides into the symmetry breaking minimum. Well, I didn't do anything like that. I kept V of phi always the same. The scalar was always, could be, let's say, always positive mass squared. It was always in this shape of potential. But the extra physics of the black hole horizon and the electric field and force balances and attempts at super radiance and so forth led you back to the scalar condensate picture. Yes, good question.
Yeah, so if I have a fermion instead of a boson, in this case, so then I don't see, even if it bounces back, it can just form a fermion surface. Why would it form a supercondensate?
The question was, what about in the case of fermions? And this is where things get subtle. One way to look at it is that just before you condense, the Green's function of the scalar has some singularity, a quasi-normal mode, which is approaching the real axis. And the imaginary part is negative, indicating that quasi-normal mode will ring down. So if you start slightly above TC and you ping the scalar field a little bit, it'll ring, but it won't condense. That's what scalar Green's functions look like above TC. And then as you cross through TC, the quasi-neural mode crosses the real axis. It gets a positive imaginary part, which means there's a runaway instability. If you ping that scalar field just a little bit, in the linearized theory, it will just run away forever. And then some nonlinear effects, like gravity, would have to cut off that, that runaway. So that's another way to understand what's going on that forms this condensate. Fermionic Green's functions are different in a profound way, that quasi-neural modes can reach up to the axis, but then they discontinuously change direction. They reach the axis, and they go back down. Exactly when they reach the axis in momentum space, that's where you have the quote, Fermi surface. So, so that's not sort of the direction I've chosen to present this, but that is a compelling way to tell the story. That it's all about the tracking of quasi-neural modes, the singularities in the complex plane of the Green's function.
Let's still look at the fermions and instability.
The question was, why would Fermi surfaces have instabilities toward superconductivity?
Based on some picture like
So the pictures that I've put up here do not refer to a Fermi surface. This is a strange feature of holographic superconductivity. Of course, in a way, it's also a strange feature of Landau-Ginzburg theory, which to my mind, in the case of holographic superconductors, has still not been fully satisfactorily understood. That in the bulk, you've got these fields like the scalar and the fermion, and they're both fundamental. They're both supposed to be coming out of the supergravity Lagrangian. It's not the case, as it would be in Landau-Ginzburg theory, that the scalar is actually a bilinear composite of fermions. That's not the deal. But it's dual to that. The dual description says that phi is going to be dual to some operator, O sub phi, which presumably does have overlap with boundary fermion Cooper pairs. So lambda lambda. I was about to write lambda bar lambda. That would be wrong. Cooper pairs are not about pairs of fermions and antifermions. They're pairs of fermion-fermion, so that they carry some non-zero charge. How to make the relationship between O phi and how to make the relationship between phi and psi more explicit is a little hard. There have been some nice papers by Hartnell and collaborators saying that if you have certain types of couplings between the fermions and the scalar, certain types of Yukawas, that makes more explicit the pairwise nature of the fermion operator. So I think let's stop here, but I'm happy to take more questions, and we'll resume at Quarter Till. Right? But go, yes.
This one picture you drew based on some bulb. This whole bulb picture.
This is definitely a bulb picture, and it's dual to something that can be easily understood. So if you have phi non-zero, then it immediately implies that O sub phi will have a non-zero condensate. Or else, you deformed the CFT Lagrangian by some constant times O sub phi. And this A, very quickly, is something like the limit as Z goes to zero of phi. There's really a power of Z in here that I'm neglecting. But I set my prescription boundary conditions for phi near the boundary of ADS, such that there's this deformation parameter vanishes. And if that prescription is made and you still get, nevertheless, a condensate, then it can only mean that there's some one-point bev of O sub phi. Yes, go ahead.
My question is, you said that something is qualitatively different in the Landau reservoir picture thing, but if I look at the Gubser Buxer boundary and try to see how does some kind of effective potential for phi is changing, it may be that even it's exactly the same as Landau reservoir.
So the suggestion was that maybe really it is the same as Landau-Gubser in the boundary theory. Sure, maybe. Let's put it this way. In terms of the easiest way to understand it, it is distinctively different from Landau-Gubser. But okay, I mean, Landau-Gubser at some level is an effective theory of every superconductor under the sun. And so I don't disagree that some version of Landau-Gubser should, in the boundary theory, should describe this. It's just that it's a complicated theory. You have to have some knowledge of the scalar potential and how it changes with temperature. And Landau-Gubser sort of parametrizes your ignorance by at least assuming that it's the quadratic term which passes through zero and everything else is analytic and smoothness arguments and so forth. Whereas this is, you know, there's much more precision here. You say, look, there's some potential, and in principle, I could get it from string theory. In fact, we really did. We did look at the consistent truncations, and we did get a potential that came directly from an M-theory compactification. And it did do exactly what I described, that there's a condensate that forms. And so there's something more informative about this picture, especially when coupled to a string theory or M-theory compactification. Than Landau-Gubser. However, it's informative in a way that doesn't tell you much about the pairing mechanism. Okay? Yes, another question.
Okay. It seems like for any temperature, you still have some finite size of atmosphere. I mean, because the strength of the field will be just different depending on the radius.
So the question was don't you have some non-zero scalar condensate at any temperature? And the answer is, at the level of mean field theory, no. When you go to a very high temperature, then the preferred state is going to be just the Reissner-Nordström state with the expectation value of phi equal to zero. And if the scalar quanta try to jump out, the temperature is so high, that means that the gravitational pull is so strong that they just get sucked right back in. So sure, there's a little bit of fluctuation of phi around phi equals zero, but it doesn't manage to run away into classical condensate. Why don't we do more questions over coffee?